Hello, my name is Swami Priyaananda. I have the great privilege of being able to share with you the integral yoga approach to meditation. Preparation for meditation. It is important both to prepare yourself as a meditator and to prepare the space in which you are going to meditate. Particularly now, many of us are in our homes, and so it would be very helpful to set up a little space for yourself that is like sort of like a little home altar. And on that altar, the first thing you do, of course, is you clean everything nicely, and then you choose lovely things to place on the altar. Perhaps a nice cloth, a candle, maybe a little incense, and a picture or a statue of something that inspires you. So you make this beautiful, lovely little space. There is a benefit, the way we sit in meditation, of facing a particular direction. Preferably, when we're meditating, whether you can see out a window or not, it doesn't matter, but if you can be facing the east or the north, it creates a nice vibrational area for you to meditate in. It's very conducive to be meditating in the direction that the sun is rising or the proper alignment with the magnetic poles. So that's where you would want to put your little table or altar, whatever you're going to set up. Then, of course, you prepare yourself. And that can be, it's nice to have a little bath or something so the body is clean and you feel energized from a beautiful shower. And then choose something that you can meditate in. The clothing should be very loose and comfortable. They should be adequately warm. You might want a little shawl like this, or just a nice light sweater, so that you choose how to dress in a way where you're sitting. Maybe you're in a hot climate, so you would want lighter clothing. Whatever it is, choose something that is very comfortable and will not distract you at all while you're meditating. And a little hint I would give to you about that is to take the clothing that you meditate in and put it in your closet and use it only for meditation, because it will absorb the vibration that is being created during meditation. Choose a particular time of day that you can be consistent with. The yogis recommend that the best times for meditation are usually right before the sun rises or in the evening as the sun sets. There is a time that yogis meditate, which usually is between the hours of 4 and 6 a.m. It's called Brahma Mahutra. And it's the hour when the earth is most quiet. Not even the birds are singing. Not that many trucks are on the road. The earth is quiet, and so it's very supportive of our meditation. So if you can choose some time in that early morning range, then you will have the support of nature. If that doesn't work with your schedule, then simply as soon as you rise, either splash a little water on the face or take a shower, and then sit a little bit the first thing in the morning before you go to work. The second best time is in the evening at sunset. So the earth is starting to quiet down from all the busyness of the day. And the sun is setting. And it's just a very conducive time for meditation. So those would be the best two times of day. But if none of that fits in with your schedule, then choose a time of day, preferably two times a day, where you can sit and try to be consistent with that, either the first thing when you wake up or right before you go to sleep. Maybe that works better for you. But whatever you choose, choose it and be consistent with it. The length of the meditation depends on your level of practice and experience. If you're a beginning meditator and you choose those two times of day, try to sit for at least 15 minutes each time. It always helps if before you begin your meditation that you mentally prepare your mind with a little chanting, a prayer, some breathing practice. All of those things will help to bring the mind in and help it to begin to focus on meditation. There is a tendency. No, I would say it is the nature of the mind to wander. You might bring it in, focus it on an object of your meditation, and within seconds, you might notice that off that mind has run. Don't get discouraged. Just simply, as soon as you notice that, bring it back. So over and over again, wherever the mind goes, bring it back to your point of concentration. That's why it's very important to choose something to meditate on that the mind enjoys, that it's interested in. Because its nature will be to wander, you bring it back and apply your chosen object, and then the mind becomes intrigued with that. And that's the process. That's called what we call dharana, or concentration. Concentration is the mind wandering and you bringing it back. Meditation, dhyana, is when the mind stays and becomes one-pointed on the focus of the object which you have chosen. What are some ways that you can help this mind to draw within and to stay focused on that? First is the breath. When you sit down, if you're tired, do some vigorous breath that will energize your system. In integral yoga, we call this breathing practice pranayama. And the more vigorous techniques are kapalabhati, skull shining breath, or bhastrika. So, bellows breath is bhastrika. So by doing one of these very, very energizing breaths, you can bring great focus to the mind. And then there are other techniques that can be used to build the mind up and help it stay focused on your object of meditation. Some of you may have experienced guided meditations. There are many that are offered on the internet. In classes all around yoga studios, people come in, lie down, and someone is there to help them go through a beautiful, lovely, relaxing, focusing of the mind and body. So that's a beautiful technique. Another technique is called Tratak, and that is gazing. You would take something like a beautiful flower, or if you have a candle on your altar, you could light the candle and focus on the flame. And in Tratak, what you do is whatever you're focusing on, you put it directly at a comfortable eye level, and then you just gently gaze. If the mind wanders, you might think about the fragrance of a flower, the color of the petals, the stamen inside. So you think of the object that you're meditating on and keep the eyes gazing steadily. And at some point, the eyes might want to close. Let them close for a moment and just see what happens from that gazing. Is there any kind of an image that stays within the mind's eye? Maybe it does, and if it's there, watch it until it fades away. When it fades away, open the eyes and continue your gazing. So Tratak is a beautiful aid if the mind is very restless to begin your meditation. It's nice to have, meditation's a very subtle practice, and so it's nice to start with a more gross expression of the universe to use as an aid to help you get into that more subtle state. Likhita Japa, which is before the formal seating meditation, we would have a different kind of meditation of sitting down, taking a particular mantra, or even an inspiring saying, and writing it out. It can either be, it should be very neat and beautiful. It's like a work of art that you're creating. And it's, you're doing it over and over and over in a very beautiful way. I have an example here, which I don't know. It's very tiny, so I don't know if it's visible. But this is someone who's done Likhita Japa in a foreign, in a different language. I think this is Tamil, the language of South India. So these mantras are written out, or it can be Sanskrit. I haven't looked at it closely enough. And so you can see, this was all written out by hand. And what a focused mind the person must have had to write everything so tiny like that, and yet still so neat. So Likhita Japa is a wonderful way of focusing the mind. And it doesn't even, you can even do it without having to use a mantra specifically. We have a school here in Yogaville, and our school children have made calendars out of Likhita Japa. And for instance, in January, they drew Martin Luther King Jr., Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., with the words, "I have a dream." And they wrote them over and over and over, creating a silhouette of him. So you can use Likhita Japa in a very, very creative way. And just repeating something over and over and over focuses and calms the mind. So those are some wonderful aids to help you bring the mind in a more quiet state. People often ask about using a mantra. Some people are very familiar with that term, and other people aren't quite sure what it means. So a mantra is just a sound vibration of two or more syllables that creates a very focusing and calming effect on the mind. This whole cosmos is nothing but sound vibrations. All of this universe is the expression of sound. We're all made of sound. So by repeating specific sounds, we bring our body to that vibrational plane. People who have gone into deep meditation have experienced these vibrational sounds and have, coming out of those states, shared those sounds with other seekers. And so by repeating those sounds which were found within, it aligned others up with the ability to have that same experience. So repeating a mantra can be a great aid to meditation. It is one of the simplest ways, but also one of the most beneficial ways. And a mantra repetition can be done in a series of ways. You can simply say it out loud I'll use, for an example, the mantra Om Shanti. So you can sit and say out loud, Om Shanti. Om Shanti. Om Shanti. And that will start to bring a calmness to the mind. Once you've done that several times, if the mind is still a little restless, then without verbalizing the sound, simply say, so that's lip movements. The lips are moving, but no sound is audibly expressed. And then finally, the lips stop to move, and you just mentally repeat that sound in the mind. And that is what how the mantra is able to take our minds from many thoughts to one thought. And when we focus on that one thought, then we come to no thoughts. So many to one to none. There is another aid, and you'll probably remember, those of you perhaps who grew up in the Catholic Church, remember seeing rosaries being used by people when they were praying. In yoga, we have something called a mala. And a mala is a string of beads that one would, while they're repeating the Om Shanti, could use to help them stay focused. So the mala can hang on, say, your ring finger, and then the thumb comes up, places itself on one of the beads, and you start repeating mentally the Om Shanti, and when you finish that sound, you draw the bead before to you, toward you. Om Shanti. Om Shanti. Om Shanti. And you would do that all the way around the mala. And usually in a mala, there are 108 beads until you would come to the one that's at the top. It's called a Meru, or the mount. And then when you get to that one, you turn the mala around and go back the other way. So this is a small crystal mala. This is a fancier mala made out of, I don't know what all of these stones are. It's quite beautiful. And then this is a Tulsi wood mala. If you're going to use a mala, it should be made of either precious stones or semi-precious stones, if you're going to use something like that. Or it can be wood, such as the Tulsi wood, sandalwood. It can be seeds. The Rudraksha beads are simply seeds. So there are different qualities of a mantra, of a mala, but it's not something that you want to really wear and decorate yourself with. It's something that you're creating that vibration in through its repetition. So if you wear it, keep it inside the clothing, close to you, or when you finish your japa, put it in a little bag and leave it there by your altar. So those are some aids. Also, throughout the day is when you want to keep the mantra going, not just when you're sitting simply in a formal meditation. And that's why a little wrist mala is something that can really be a great aid to you. So again, you would put it on one of the fingers and just Om Shanti. Om Shanti. Om Shanti. All day long, you can have something like that. There are even rings that you could have something as you're riding home on the bus. No one even would even know you're doing japa. But you're having a little aid there to remind you to do the japa. So that's a great, great benefit in getting the mantra well established within you, because your mind, its nature is to run. So if it runs, okay, find something that will enable you to refocus it and keep it steady. And once this repetition brings you to the purpose of the meditation, which is to bring the mind into a very calm and focused state, then all of these aids can just be put aside. But these are wonderful, wonderful practices. And this is a picture of a yantra that can be meditated on. And this is very conducive to meditation. You can frame it and put it on your wall, and you look right at the very dot and center of the yantra. And it has a way of quickly focusing the mind. Here you see a very plain and simple aspect of a yantra, and here you see a more ornate aspect of yantra. This is the integral yoga yantra that we use here. So it can be as simple and plain as you want or ornate, but it should have that inward center focus. I encourage you to go on the internet today, and you can find a whole slew, from blood pressure to all kinds of benefits that happen to the physical body. But I would like to address some of the more subtle things, or things that people may not be aware of that are occurring in this practice of meditation. First, the benefit of meditation is that it purifies the ego. In integral yoga, we are asked to make our egos as pure as a crystal. There's nothing wrong with the human ego. We need to have a sense of I-ness. But at the same time, the ability to not be so locked in to our own perspective in the world, or to feel like, I have to take care of this myself. I can do this. Often, it's only when very difficult things come up in our lives that we call on that divine energy, and we are brought to our knees and we say, I can't do this by myself. Please help me. And whatever you call out to is up to you. But that getting to that point in meditation, and also in our daily life, to realize, I can't do this alone. I need some help. It's humbling. And that brings a sense of gratitude and humility to the mind. And it's quite calming when you realize the burden is not on your shoulders. So meditation can bring us to that experience. Another thing that meditation does is that it opens your heart. You really begin to experience as the energy moves. Most of us keep our energy focused in the lower aspects of our body. We're trying to create families. We're trying to become accomplished in our professions. We're dealing with creation and power struggles and all kinds of things. So we're really locked in to the energy staying in those very foundation of our being so that we can accomplish these things. But once we move into meditation, that energy begins to move up within us. And when the heart opens, then the light comes. So that beautiful experience of saying, I need help, I can't do this, and of feeling that now our energy is moving into that what's called chakra, the heart chakra, that center, nerve center, as that begins to open and we begin to feel that light and that love within us, that helps us to be more compassionate with ourselves. And when we see our own shortcomings and weaknesses and we have compassion for them, that will also occur with others in this world. So the heart begins to open from this beautiful practice of meditation. And what that will result in is the mind begins to calm, to focus, and it becomes very clear and calm. And in that state, we can have that highest experience of who we truly are. We're all just spirit. We're walking around in different bodies from different cultures and different upbringings. But that spirit resonates within each of us, and not just us human beings, but all of nature, the animals, the plants, everything is that spirit expressing itself in all these wonderful forms. So those are the beautiful experiences that meditation practice can bring to our lives. I hope that you really give it a try and see some peace and joy expanding in your life. Om Shanti.